Session is going to start recording now. It is recording. I'm just going to put your slides on now for you. There we go. So I'm handing over to you, Anuradha, and I'm going to be quiet now. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you very much. Shall I start now? Am I audible?
Yes, please. You've got the control.
Yeah. Okay. Right. I'm representing two universities current now because I'm working at the University of Moratuwa, and I'm a PhD student at the University of Colombo School of Computing, Sri Lanka. And I'm Anuradha Perumugamage from Sri Lanka. Today I'm going to present a framework to support problem-based learning. It's very widely used, the problem-based learning, but with the pandemic and the situation, we were searching different pedagogies and the methods to work with the online environment. So this is my main output of my MPhil study. Right. As a brief, I will tell you where I am from. I'm from Sri Lanka, and it's a pearl of the Indian Ocean, and it's with the cultural and with heritage with the Asian countries. So today, before starting my session, I will like to emphasize you the David Kolb saying. He says that learning is the process where knowledge is created through the transformation of experience. So having that idea in your mind, we will move on to the session. So as an icebreaker, I would like to ask you what you can see in this picture or in this slide. So if you all can chat, or if you can tell me what you can see, then it's as icebreaker, then we can move on to the presentations today. Anybody?
A dog with a hat.
A dog with a hat, yes. Any? German Shepherd, yeah. A dog with a hat, yeah. Good. Any more? Right. Most of you are saying that a dog with the hat, and it's a German Shepherd dog like that. So as you all know, how we knew that it's a dog, right? Or how we know he's wearing a hat, likewise. So where we get to know those things? It's something where we read, or something where we have daily seen, or else someone has told me at when we were kids, they told me if there's four legs and something like that, if he's barking, it's a dog, right? So that is what we call the things we get to know from our teachers or our peers or the people who are around us. We get to know that. And also we told that it's a German Shepherd, right? So how that name comes, or how that the breed comes. So those are things which we learn through our teachers or things. But if we say that he's wearing a hat, then we can say that it's a magic hat and he's a magic shepherd, right? So how it comes like that? So that is what we need, the problem-based learning, where without learning the things from the teacher, we need to get an idea through the day-to-day life. So what the traditional learning is, someone is speaking or someone is told to us, and we get to know that, and we memorize things, and we try to assign that things to, or try to illustrate those things into our day-to-day life. But problem-based learning is not like that. It's basically the problem, and we have to identify the needs, and then we have to identify what we have to do. Different solutions are there, but not only the one solutions. We can have a different solutions, and we find different things to apply to solve problem. So it's a mainly student-centric teaching learning environment, and also students try to train their brain, right? So without getting memorizing things, they try to work with groups and peers or the people around them, and trying to search things, and then only they are finding to find solution to break the problem or find the solution to the given problem. So then only they are training their brain to critically thinking and work with the team. So that is what we call problem-based learning. Now, when it comes to the problem-based learning and why we need the problem-based learning, so that, is there any advantage than the teacher-centered education? We have to think about that. So it's a mainly problem solving and improve the research skills as well. So that's what we need day-to-day life without getting things just applying. We need to research on it. And then the social skills. We have to work with the people and we need to improve our social skills. And then effectiveness. Also, we have to work with the team wherever we are working. We need to work with a team and we need to collaborate each other without having any fights or whatever the things, right? So we may have conflicts, but there should be a way to solve problems, right? So that skill should be improved throughout our education system, right? And then the decision making. And also we need to have a constructive feedback without hitting them to saying different things with harsh things, right? And also the flexibility. We have to have a flexible system. And what are the challenges now if we are talking about such a good thing as a problem-based learning, and why the people are not introducing it? Is there any problems we have to, or the challenges, right? So the thing is, we have learned a lot of things throughout our journey in the traditional way of learning, teacher-centered education. But the people are reluctant, or it's difficult to change over with the traditional to PBL. Why? We have to develop different teacher materials, and also we have to find the different scenarios. So it's a big hassle for us, right? So then the assessment. So normally we are giving a paper and students need to answer for that. And traditional assessment does not well in the PBL because we need to have a different assessment scheme, right? That is also a challenge. And then free rider tracking to challenge in PBL, because if we are working with the group, they might think that now I am okay, I can work anywhere and I can pass the subject or whatever the things, because it's a group work. They might think that I can work without doing any work, I can pass the exam or whatever the things, what the challenge they are going. So that is also a challenge. And then the time consumed, but the people may think it is the time consuming thing, but it is not exactly the time consuming, because if we have prepared well, we do not need to consume very much time. Initially we need to have a time, but that is not a very much challenging task. Then we need to have a proper communication tools and protocols are required, right? Because without having the proper communications or tools, we can't go with the problem-based learning, or we can't work as a teacher or educator with this, right? So those challenges we should be overcome when we are going to practice the PBL, because that is the main reluctance to go for a PBL environment, right? So is there a place where the PBL is practicing? Actually, this has started in 1969, McMaster University. They have started, that is the health science, Faculty of Health Science, and then they introduced into chemical engineering as well. And then the Aalborg University, Denmark, they are also practicing. And there are different other universities, they are practicing in Delaware, 1993, and 2002, Republic of Polytechnic. And there are other Indian universities, and they are practicing it with the university-wide, or curriculum-wide, or course-wide. This is not the way we can access to the whole curriculum, but we can have in a different stages in our modules or the courses, right? So we can practice this with this very good learning, the pedagogy that can be implemented, and this has been a success in throughout past years. So this module that I'm discussing here, we have trying to practice it to the engineering education, because we found that it's a very we can apply this into engineering education as well, not only the science or medical or whatever the other environment, we can go with the engineering education as well. So before going to that, we will find where the PBL principles come from. Now it's a early 1974 is that it's a problem orientation, and they find that it's an interdisciplinary experimental learning, participation directed team or group. Then it has evolved with the Burroughs. It introduced in 1996. It says that the problems form the focus and stimulus for the learning. Now there is a problem and we have to focus on that, and then only we have to start our stimulate our learning cycle. So problem are vehicle for development problem solving skills. New information is acquired through the self-directed learning. So the Burroughs found that student, it's a student-centered small group will be work well, and that mainly teacher works as a facilitator, not as a mentor, or teacher work as a mentor or a facilitator, not as a teaching person, right? And then spoon feeder, without going to the traditional way, it's a spoon feeder, teacher work as a spoon feeder, but it Burroughs found that it not will work in the problem-based learning environment. He should be a facilitator or the guide person. And then it comes to 2003, Graf found that the start with the problem, and he found that it's three domain we have to work with: learning or the cognitive, social and content. So in the learning environment, it's a problem, active-based learning, project-oriented, we can go with the case-based and contextual learning, and the social, that we have to participate direct team-based learning. Likewise, we have different other scenarios he have mentioned. Now in this context, I am focusing on the stage where we have to focus on is the Kolmos 2003 introduced this model, and we are focusing on this model. It has combination of Burroughs model as well. And then where the theories come from? Now, PBL learning, we have to, as I mentioned earlier, that's the social content and learning we have to focus on. And here, social constructivism, experiential learning, peer learning, collaborative learning, different learning theories we can apply to the problem-based learning. But in this, in my today's presentations, I'm focusing on the experiential learning, which has introduced by the Kolb. Because the mainly I'm focusing on the engineering education, and it's a practical based education thing. So therefore we have to focus on the experience way of learning teaching aspects. So where Kolb's experience and learn cycle and where it start from? So it has a four stages, right? Kolb learning cycle proposed that we all learn from our experience in a cyclic way. So as we know, we can't just swim without having a experience knowledge, right? So what we have to first, we have to have a good idea how we can do it, and we have need a coach, and then only we can follow up, and then we have to have the why experience, only we can be a good swimmer. Likewise, in the learning cycle also, it's a cyclic way of learning, he mentioned that. So where it comes from, people observe something happening and reflect on their observation. First we see things, and then only we try to reflect them, our observation, and this experience reflects in the incorporated into theoretical knowledge. Then we are going to find our abstract or the conceptualized knowledge, and then only we complete the cycle with the concrete experience, with having the activities and experiences. Now, as a summary, for the key elements of the PBL, we can summarize, this is a pedagogical model to bridge the knowledge gap between education and the work. Now, it's a pedagogical model where we have to have a knowledge gap. We have to fill that gap between the work and the education. So there we have different scenarios, PBL principle, methods to analyze, and the steps to follow, and different formal principles. Now, if you consider the principles, now tutor, chairperson, board writer, like us, different members are there. If you consider the PBL principles, collaborative learning, constructive learning, contextual learning, self-directed learning, there are different kind of learners we found. And then the method of analysis, brainstorming, concept mapping. So we need to have analytical method. And the main concern is what are the steps we have to follow. In the problem-based learning, we have different steps, different theories, and different people suggest different things. But mainly we have to have a major 7 steps. Explore the current problem, and then you have to formulate it, and then analyze the problem, and then restructuring and map. And then we have to do the learning goals, and individually we have to study all the research and do the studies, and then only final evaluation and learning process. So that is the basic idea of normal problem-based learning. But in my context, I'm going to discuss about how we can move this with the technologically with the mobile applications. Why I am talking about the mobile applications, because in Sri Lankan context, we don't have much devices. Everyone not owning a desktop or a computer or the laptop or whatever thing. But majority of students are using, even in the in my research, I found that 90 to 95% of students are using mobile smart devices like mobile phones, right? Therefore, they have to work with their mobile phone now in the COVID pandemic. Now it's almost 2 years, 1.5 years, students have to work in the remotely. So they had to face difficulties when working with the Zoom or whatever the online environment. So they need to have a good learning environment with their mobile phone. So that's why we are focusing how we can map this problem-based learning into the small device, problem-based learning into the small device, smart device. Now, this framework showed the effective strategies of integrating e-learning, problem-based learning for engineering and technical education. So this is introduced by the Dr. Trasi in 2005. They have used this in the for the e-learning concept, and I also adapted this model because it's an online environment. What they have done is they have taken that major steps into few other steps. So they are mainly focused on the group formation, and then only they are allocating the facilitators. Now in our environment in Sri Lankan context, for a particular module, we have only one facilitator, or we can say lecturer or a teacher. But it's there are a lot of students registered for a course. Now more than 100 students registered for a course, but it's very difficult to handle for the one person. But this concept, what they have, the teacher working as a facilitator, and there are small groups, and they have allow the different facilitator to facilitate their or the as a guide. They are promoting the main teacher as well as the other facilitators, and then teacher present the problem. What is the problem? It should be a real world scenario, and then the problem is presented with the discussion with the peers and other facilitators, and then they have to identify the learning related facts. Here RLF is learning related facts, identification of facts with the different sources. It can be a library, it can be a or another person or the industry, whatever the way, they have to identify the learning resources facts with, to come up with this the solution. There's no one solution for one problem, right? There may be a different solution. If I say asking to develop a lock for a door, then there's one solution. But if we have to teach the student to work with the problems with related to your subject area, then there should be a different solution for that, right? Then after finding all the facts and the scenarios and the knowledge they taken from the students and teacher and other resources, then he has to do the self study. Then only once he is doing the self study, then he need to have a resource sharing among the peers and others as well to come up with the solution. Then finally they have to propose different solution as a group, and at the end only they may present a solution, and that can be evaluated through the facilitator or the person who is evaluating. That is the model or the framework introduced by Tazir. But I have used this and as an experimental model, and after developing my model, I found that there should be a different changes to this model as well. I will discuss it later. And what I have done by using that model, I use the Moodle platform, right? So PBL activities in Moodle environment, you may have practiced it. And also we have the Moodle plugin for this mobile activity. So what we have done in the Moodle environment, normally the students are familiar with the web-based environment, and we given the exercises to solve the problem by giving literal lectures, group studies, and problem. And likewise, all the scenarios were given through as a problem, and the activities are designed because we have a learning objectives. From that, we our courses were designed to match that learning objective with the problem-based scenario. Same objectives, but we have designed the full course according to the match the environment. And then we have given it, so we were guides to the student. We've given the chat forums and different journal articles, and we have given the wiki activities, the workshop activities, how they perform through their mobile application. And also to support this one, we have developed a different plugin to match the PBL environment. And then we found different frameworks were there already introduced from different researchers. Cooley has in 2019 there's a framework introduced by Analyst of Mobile Education, and there's another framework pen in 2009, the conceptual framework, and 2011 it's a pedagogical framework, and there's another framework, it's analysis of the pattern. But in our scenario, we have developed the pedagogy. It's a theoretical framework. These all frameworks were analyzing and giving the model in the other scenarios. But when we are doing the mobile-based learning activities through the Moodle environment, we found that there are difficulties to in the platform. Now, as you all know, the didactical triangle introduced by we have mainly focused on the content and student and the teacher. Now, our focus is not to give the full content or the knowledge, right? So what we need to have the student-teacher interact as a training. Now, teacher gives the training or the teaching by using the content to the student. And student access the content through the platform or the learning environment, as I mentioned earlier, in the Moodle platform or the plugin or whatever the environment we are giving, student access those things. Now, what we are trying to emphasize in here, students have their own expectations, value, intentions when they come to their activities, or when they are registered for the course, they have their own expectation. And also teacher has their own plan, intentions, goals, values, where we need to get to the student. And for that, the teacher develop their course activities and content with which share through them. So when the student training with the teacher, or if the teacher train the student, we have to find who the teacher should be, know that who is my audience, or the what sort of students I have, because we have to come up with the solution to address all the students. By as you all know, when you are go to the class, there may be a different kind of learners. So our problem is, in the traditional environment, are we satisfying all the students' requirements or their expectations? But in the problem-based learning, we have to satisfy all the students' expectations. For that, teacher should have to have a good idea who are the learners, and then how I can provide the teaching materials or the guidance to come up with their expectation and the values, to improve the values. So then we need to find the good learning environment for that to learn the student and get the knowledge. So teachers trying different methods and roles to give that knowledge to the student by having a different content. Content may be a PowerPoint slide, video, or other activity, or whatever the things we can share with the students. So that is the didactical triangle represented here. In our case, we have focused on all three scenarios when implementing the plugin as well as the framework. And then, as you know, now we are going to introduce the technological devices to the students or the teacher. There may be a students who are not familiar with the technological environment. Even in our case, if we are going to implement the PBL environment through the web base, we had to face difficulties with our teachers, because they are reluctant to use as I mentioned, the PBL. We have different challenges to move from the traditional way to the PBL environment. And we found different learners are in there, and also different kind of teachers are there to get involved with the technical devices. So So in the technology adoption model, in the Davis introduced a model in 1989, there are external variables, and when we are going to introduce a new technology, we have to consider about the perceived usefulness, perceived easiness, and also the attitudes. So we have to change the attitudes of the person if we are going to introduce a new technological devices for any kind of scenario, not only for the teaching learning environment. We have to find the attitude change and also behavioral intention. So then only after that we match all the perceived usefulness, easy of access, and the attitude change and behavioral intent. When we match all the things, only we can go to the actual system. To do that, as diffusion innovation theory, Rogers mentioned that there are people, when there is an invention or when there is a new product, there are 25% of people, they try to take that when they come to the industry, and early adapters, and they are early majority. But the thing is, when you are going to introduce a system to our curriculum or a course or whatever the things, we have to think that we have to know that there are people who are reluctant to go. Those are the people in the late majority or the laggard. So there is a 50% of people are not willing to go for that. There may be a 50% of students or the teachers may accept this. So we have to find that aspect as well when you are going to introduce a new learning teaching methodology. So in introducing our method or the framework, we have to come up with this. We have a focus on these theories as well, the didactical triangle and the diffusion innovation theory and the technological adaption model for that. And finally, for finding these things, as a researchers, we have found that there are motivators and barriers according to the technology adaption model for the teachers. These barriers were identified from the teacher point of view, and the student point of view, we found that students are very keen to use their technological devices. Only thing is, they need to have the training to work with the activities and the scenarios. If we can guide the students properly with the proper advisors and proper learning teaching plan, and the teaching plan, then students are very willing to do their activities. Only thing is, we need to have a good aspect, good training with the teachers. So teachers have the different motivators to use the devices or the technologies, or as I mentioned, mobile devices with the different framework. We have found it, those things according to the technology adoption model: perceived easiness, perceived usefulness, and attitude, behavior, intention. So when we come take the perceived easiness, they try to they are motivated to tradition and easy of work, ICT competencies, convenience with the workload reduction. Those kind of things were thinking when they are adopting a technological. And usefulness, they may think about the industry requirement, accreditation process. Now we are talking about the engineering education, so they might think about those aspects as well. And then attitudes, personal interest and use of technologies, and also they are thinking about the peer recognitions. Those kind of things they were thinking on as a motivator. And behavioral intention point, the credit towards promotion, use of technology, and use of technology by the other international institute. And also they found that the lack of human resource support for their learning teaching activities. Now during the pandemic, they have to work it at home. So therefore they may have to find their own way of solutions. So the intention also matters. And what are the barriers they found that to implement these kind of things, funding and instructional designing. Now, as I mentioned in the very beginning, the problem-based learning, we can't go with the traditional way of teaching learning material. We need to have a different way of, we have to completely change our teaching plan. So instructional design, we need to change. And also technical support and their competency of ICT. And in Sri Lankan context, we don't have good internet connection. That is also a major concern to go with the new technological devices. And then the usefulness, why they were lack in the institutional support and policies, And the concern about the student access in the Sri Lankan context, there are rural areas and where their students come from in the state universities. So they may be having problems with that. And also the quality of the work and the quality of the materials they are giving. So those also are matters. And then the attitude point of view, what they have talked about, the lack of time to develop the content with the workload and the support given from the university and the lack of technology enhanced learning materials and training. Now when the pandemic comes, the sudden change, they don't have a good training on technological devices. They were practicing only the traditional way of teaching learning, and they had a they didn't have a good training for the technology enhanced learning. So, and also there was no role model to follow. So those are the issues they had. And then the behavioral intention point, their barriers were lack of credit towards promotion. Now there's no promotion or nothing credits given to the person who is using these technological devices or the technological methodologies, different pedagogies. So they won't think about those things. Therefore, they are reluctant to go for the activities. As I mentioned at the very beginning, the very workload is very high. Therefore, they are they won't think about the different way of teaching methods and the development of activities. But the as I mentioned, now in the Moodle environment, we have developed a plugin, and by giving that, the teachers were very interested to use that. And then we come up with a framework with the practice with the engineering education. And also not only for the engineering education or the teaching learning, it can be practiced with the different environment. Now here the framework consists of three aspects, the didactical triangle, and it combines with the technology adoption model. And also at the end, we have combined the technology adoption model, didactical triangle, and the main steps of the problem-based learning. Now in the middle of the second, you can see the didactical triangle is placed because its content and the student and the teacher is there, right? So the when we consider the learning or the student and content, the mainly perceive usefulness matters. And then when we consider the content and the teacher or the teaching aspects, the perceive ease of use versus matters. So we have to consider that. And when we are developing the learning teaching materials, if we are developing a problem-based learning activities, we have to consider about the perceived ease of use and perceived usefulness. And then when we consider about the student-teacher relationship, it's a training. So behavior is matter. Altogether, when we consider the content, teacher, student, and if we are go for a new technological device or new way of teaching, the attitude matters. So we have placed the attitude in the middle of the our diagram. So why it's a key point where we have to consider when we are going to change our module teaching, the way of teaching or the particular way of teaching a module to the students, right? So therefore the attitude matters and perceive usefulness when we developing the learning contents or materials or whatever the thing. Usefulness is matters because sometimes there may be different kind of contents. The students may not read or may not listen or whatever things, but there should be an active way of doing that. And then when it comes to the outer layer, the other thing is identification of learning facts. Now, learning facts is the where we find the content. So if we want to find the learning facts, there should be a way of the finding the content. And then when it comes to the content and the teacher, problem presentations or the solutions gives. Now the teacher is the person who is giving the problem to the student and they have to find the solution. And the evaluation point of view, teacher is the person who is evaluating. And also in the Malayalam side, I will tell you the evaluation, we need to have not only the teacher, we have to have a different kind of evaluation methods as well if you are practicing the PBL. And then the facilitator allocation, now for the training, we need to have a facilitator allocation, and that is the behavior and the attitude matter when the facilitators are there, because sometimes student may not be able to take the find the facilitator, or they are, he will not be able to get the information which he the student really expect from the facilitator. So the facilitator allocation is very much important. And then the group formation, sometimes there may be a teacher, they are asking a student to form group, and also there may be a way of grouping with the random group formation. So students may have the flexibility of group formation if they can do the group formation by their own, because they are very familiar with their peers and they will not know how they can communicate. Then the group activities and collaborative learning is a different thing, because we have to find the initially there may be a place where a student need to get to know the each other, and then only the conflicts may be arise. But if the student form their own grouping, then they may be very much familiar with their peers, and they will be go ahead with their group activities because they are very familiar with, or they are very convenient with the their own groups. And then the resource sharing, so that will happen through the students as well as the their peers and other group members. Maybe for the learning purposes they may be share resources. So that is how we have developed this framework. Now when you consider, or when you are developing activities through the mobile or the whatever the devices, so we have to find whether we are giving the correct device for the students or the teacher, and correct way of forming, not only for the devices. Now we know the PBL is the practicing in early 70s, so now it's almost more the century they are passing, so they might be practicing it in a very good way, but if it comes to the technological way, we have to think about the other aspects as well. Now where the beneficiaries come from this, if we are developing a such kind of a framework, or the if we are developing such kind of environment for the students to learn, so teacher will be support with the PBL activities, and the student learn with the authentic tasks, collaborative tasks, and they try to train their brain with the critical thinking, and they will improve their cognitive abilities. And the as the instructional designers, they may have to practice the facilitators as a clear path, because they know where to go and where to address and how to develop the content and what is the aim. So there is a clear aim. And then the course content outline creators, they may get the basic idea of the problem-based development. And then so what sort of things we have to consider when developing the, or the factors to consider when delivering a course via PBL in a mobile environment, right? So the as I mentioned, in the PBL activities, there are seven activities, the problem presentation. Now, when you are presenting a problem, or when you are giving a problem to the students, first thing is it should be a real world scenario, because it otherwise there is no way of giving a same task. If the student can find a Google search and find the solutions, then that is not a problem-based learning. They can search and find solutions, right? So, and also that problem should be subdivided with each other. Now, if the group members are there, group members should be work together to achieve a different task, and they should be have a different task to work with that. Otherwise, the free rider will be come up with, will be use this concept. So therefore, we can't entertain the free rider. So the solution should, can be subdivided. And then the it should be a challenging task or the complex. And the student should be engaged with the different tasks. Otherwise, if they don't have a challenge in that, they will not critically think. So they are, if there is a single solution, that is not again a good problem based learning concept. So there may be a different solutions to find the problem. So when we are working with the student, we found that they quote that saying that a real world problem helped me to understand the theory that I learned. Working as a team and dividing the problem among the members helped to work effectively and efficiently, because they know if they can subdivide the task, they can achieve their solutions very efficiently. And the learning fact identification, now it should be easy to search and inquire, because they are working with the mobile environment, and they should be easy to share as well. an audio, video, or the text, where if you are giving a different learning facts or supporting facts to the student, that should be easy way of sharing, because they are working with their mobile environment, that they're concerned about their data and the facilities they have. So that's a flexible way of engaging, but they need to have, they are considering about their mobile chargers and those things, right? So the supporting quote, it says flexible way of ensuring the engagement that makes me feel responsible and get a self-paced learning environment. And the resource sharing point of view, they, as I mentioned earlier, they consider about the bandwidth and the file size that they have shared. And the next thing is group formation. The small groups, like 3 to 4 members, are very ideal situation. And the random group formation also a good way. And they found that is also a good way of teaching, a good way of learning, because they support in court said that I found that forming small working group is a positive way of getting people to interact with one another, allowing me to project myself as a real person. And also one other person said that ensuring equal participation, because if the less number of students are there, they can divide their tasks and work group with the challenging environment. And the facilitator allocation, per group 1 to 2 facilitators, the students suggest if they can have industry expert for a few hours. Also they might be helpful for when they are coming up with the solution, because not only the teacher and also the industry expert to get an ideas with the real world scenarios. And the evaluation point of view, self-evaluation, peer evaluation, group peer evaluation, teacher evaluation. That is a very important, because self-evaluation matters how they can evaluate themselves. And then the peer evaluation, because if the students were getting the other students' work, and if they know their work from each other evaluated by their peers, they will get more motivated to work with. And also the group evaluation, the group wise evaluate their different tasks, because we are giving the same problem. At the end, they may be come up with a different solution. Then they may might think, why I haven't think like that, but they have think like that. So what the difference between that and their solutions, and when they are go to the industry, how they were perform. And finally, teacher can evaluate, as we already know, as we are almost doing that. So those are the things we have to consider when giving the problem-based learning aspect with the technological environment. So from that, I have, with this research work, we thought of revising the framework we have taken, the adapted. So we have introduced the evaluation, because it should be emphasized, self, peer, group, and teacher evaluation should be, or they must be there to complete the problem-based learning task. So that will be easily do when we are working with the mobile environment, because self-evaluation, peer evaluation can be done easily with the mobile environment. And when we consider the framework, now what are the things or the key takeaways we can take from the framework? Individual interactions, because now normally in the normal teaching learning way, if you are doing the Zoom activities or the Teams activities, the individual interactions we will not be able to monitor. And every students will not get fair chance to engage in the active learning. Now, our purpose in the problem-based learning, we have to engage with all those students, and we have to facilitate the all learners' motivation or the all learners' intention to learn, right? So therefore, the individual learner interaction should be there. And the next thing is learning is enhanced through collaborative engagement. So learners get opportunity to work with groups, review peer activities, share their course materials, and they were fully actively participate with the course activities. Then they find that they are not isolated in the pandemic situation. They should have to have a good motivation to learn, because without now they are staying at home, and that the pandemic, they gave the, they may be isolated. So this group learning activities, they may not isolated. And the student approach multiple flexible way to resolve problem, issues or questions. So they found there are different ways to solve problems. Nowadays, the student may go for the suicide or whatever the other things when they find the difficulties to find solution, because they don't think there is only a one solution for one problem. No, there are different solutions for a problem, so they may learn that as well. And teacher provide more facilities of learning than direct instruction, because he will be, teacher will be giving more facilities, and he also get up to date with the learning of the teaching aspects, and allow students to reflect, measure their own learning progress throughout the course, because there is a peer, the self-evaluation, and he will monitor themselves as well. And peer assessment, individual or group assignment, teacher assignment through the assignment examination allow student to teacher to monitor learning progress, because from the beginning, students should be monitored, each and every student. Therefore, there may be not left out students. Teaching presence, now that is the very much important, rather than teacher presence, because the here is the teaching is the present teach, not the teacher. We don't need the teacher present, because we need only the peer teaching and the group, the self-direct learning, and also the facilitator learning. And there are different kind of ways learning. We don't need the teacher actually. We need to have a facilitator with the teaching person. So those are the things, key takeaways we can take from the activities. And we have practiced this with the 3 or 5 courses, and we found that is very helpful, and also it's very useful form of pedagogy to or the activity to adapt to the any environment. So those are the things, these are the key references which I have taken to do that. And thank you for listening. I think it's time for, if you have any questions or whatever, the clarifications.
Well, thank you very much. That was really, really good. We have got a couple of minutes if anybody does have any questions. Either feel free to pop something in the chat, or please do pop your hand up if you'd like to ask any questions. I think we can probably make your slides available as well, can we, Anuradha, if that's okay, if people would like them. Really interesting. Yeah. I'm also a PhD student myself as well, so I'm always fascinated by theoretical frameworks. That's really, really helpful. Thanks ever so much. Right, Emma is asking if you could just pop the reference slide up again, if that's okay. Awesome. Lovely. But yes, we'll, as a matter of course, we will send you the recording of today's webinar, but we could also send you the slides as well if you'd find those helpful. Lovely. I can't see any more questions as such in the chat. No, doesn't look like it. Any more, just any comments if you don't have any questions? That would be helpful. No, doesn't look like it. So if people do want to get in touch with you, they can obviously email you on that address, is it?
Yes.
Awesome. Yes. That's great. We'll also issue Open Digital badges for attendance at today's session as well. And there's also a presenter badge now, so you'll also get that. And then we'll link to the abstract page for you as well. Oh, that's lovely. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you very much for your comment.
Thank you.
Lovely. And brownie points to Emma for using the emojis. Well done, Emma. Love to see a little heart on there. Oh, there's a question from Uwe. Would you use live briefs as problems, e.g. engaging with an employer?
Yeah, we can use that now. If you are designing activities with industry or would you use live brief? Yeah, you can use in the live brief the problem, because without knowing the correct problem, student may be misled. So if they want to engage with the employers or whatever the thing, as the example say, so they can have a live briefing, no issue, because there may be different ways to get engaged with that. Am I answers correctly, or would you use live brief as problem?
Is that okay, Uwe? Does that answer your question or do you have a follow-up one? Lovely, great. Makes sense. Super. Thanks ever so much for your question. That's great. Lovely. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Emma. Emma's got some more. She's got a smiley face on there now. Excellent. Well, it looks as if there's a lot of love for you in the chat there. Thank you ever so much for sharing your research with us. It's really, really helpful. And thank you, everybody, for joining us. And I wish you all a good day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity. And also, thank you very much for my supervisors as well. So,
No
thank you
problem.
all signing for the session.
Lovely. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Bye.